ASMR review show. For this video, we are going to be talking about the Best Picture nominees for the 2022 Oscars, recognizing the best in film from the year 2021. Sort of. I mean, let's be real. I know lots of people aren't a fan of the Oscars anymore. And, you know, Hollywood awards ceremony. You know, lots of patting themselves on the back, that sort of thing. And the whole, like, them not gonna televise certain categories this year, right, to make more time for fancy hosts and celebrities and this Twitter fan favorite award, right? Like, I get all of that hate. Still personally believe in some value in the Oscars, because yes, there is a lot of backdoor politics to it. Yes, there's definitely Oscar bait movies that get more of a chance of being recognized, but it's not like the Grammys where they just give whatever was the most popular or sold the most the award, right? I mean, I don't hate on Marvel movies, I enjoy them, but, you know, let's be real, if the Oscars were like the Grammys, they would just give, like, Black Widow and Spider-Man all of the awards, because those movies made lots of money, and lots of people went to see them, and that's not how it's going, right? So there's still a little bit more of a critical approval required, and a lot of times there are movies that I would not have heard of or checked out if I hadn't seen that they were the frontrunners for lots of the big Oscar awards. So, looking over the nominations for Best Picture this year, there was a lot of stuff I actually liked, and there was a lot of stuff that caught my attention, like, oh, I think that movie is worth checking out. So, you know, I'm not totally against the Oscars yet, and we're gonna look at this as a chance to go over 10 very fine films, for the most part, and I'm gonna try and rank them, but when I do movie rankings, I always feel like I change my mind halfway through. And also, if you watched my video on the top 10 movies of 2021, crazy enough, 4 of the movies I talked about made it into the Oscars Best Picture list, so, you know, maybe we're both on to something together, right? And there were a lot of movies that got snubbed. I'll just rattle off a few movies that I think could have also deserved the Best Picture nomination. One was The Last Duel, by Ridley Scott. That was a great movie. 0 Oscar nominations. I kind of figured it was gonna happen, but it was still a little disappointing, nonetheless. And then, The Tragedy of Macbeth. That one has some awards for it, but not a Best Picture or Best Director nod. And that's a little disappointing. That movie was such a cool throwback to, like, a classic Bergman, Seventh Seal style film, but still new, and oh, such a crazy movie, you know, and very dense, you know, old classic Shakespeare, very dense, but very good. And then, well, I wasn't expecting The Green Knight to get a Best Picture nod, but maybe at least cinematography or visual effects, you know, either of those would have been nice. And I can't believe Lady Gaga got snubbed for House of Gucci, because that movie's pretty good. Not a masterpiece, but, you know, that was the big draw to the movie, watching Lady Gaga just showing that she understood the assignment, right? Oh well. Anyway, let's not waste any more time. Let's get going. So, 10 movies in ranked order. Bottom of the list, number 10, is Well, it's the one most people are dissing on, and it's don't look up. Oh, nope, don't look up. Yeah, a lot of people didn't like that this one was nominated, and I remember seeing so many comment threads like, "Ugh, don't look up, literally the worst movie I've seen all year." And I'm not fully on board with the hate train. The thing with this movie, I guess we could add this to my unpopular opinions. I didn't hate it, but I didn't love it. I think the frustrating thing for me is Don't Look Up is a movie where I really love the concept and the idea behind it, the setup, but the execution, the film making behind it, I really didn't like. So this is definitely a very satirical, dark comedy and intentionally over the top, poking fun at reality. And it's got a very Doctor Strangelove vibe in that sort of way, you know, taking a potential end of the world scenario, and unfortunately, all of the leaders and people pulling all the strings and making all the decisions are just so incompetent. You just realize, like, oh man, we're screwed, aren't we? Right? You know, like in Doctor Strangelove, right? Has he got a chance? Has he got a chance? Hell yeah. Right. That's basically what it is. And obviously, this movie was made in mind as being a climate change metaphor, but definitely could apply to the pandemic as well, you know? It's just. And that is the point. It is silly, and it's dumb, and it's over the top. It's a very cathartic movie, you know? It's a lot of venting through the film process. So I like all that as a concept and a style. I was on board for this movie. But I really did not like the directing and the editing, and that's another thing. This movie's up for best editing, and I'm like, best editing, more like most editing. Like, let me put it this way. I actually like the Bohemian Rhapsody Queen biopic movie. A lot of people didn't. And a lot of people point out that that movie has bad editing, and I actually didn't really notice it until, like, kind of paying close attention. For some reason, it didn't, like, stick out, or it didn't bother me. I don't know. Like, I didn't notice anything was wrong. But the editing in this one, yeah, it was very bad. Like, it'd be like characters talking, and then does a random cutaway to, like, a statue or a picture on the wall, but the cutaway shot is not long enough for you to observe what you're being shown, and it's also not quick enough to be that it was meant to be like a single frame flash subliminal message. But it's also not necessarily like something plot relevant. It's like we just cut to a character's POV and they're just randomly staring at something, and we see the thing they're staring at, but it's nothing. Or then there'd be montage sequences of, like, nature, and the montage had, like, a very odd rhythm to it. Like, there was no sense of, like, pace or meter, and that just kind of really threw me off, you know? Like, here's a long, quick, long, quick song. It seems an odd thing to complain about, but it really took me out of the experience. And I know that this was a made-for-Netflix movie, but I feel like in the special effects department, it was very, like, made-for-TV. You know, it was definitely trying to show stuff beyond what the budget was capable of. But spoiler alert, the ending to the movie with the comet destroying Earth, that scene was actually quite touching, you know, and those final lines, like, man, Studios bit where he goes on the rant, you know, the president of the United States is lying. Like, those isolated moments are good, but thrown in together with everything else, I wasn't that big of a fan. So, I don't know if this movie's gonna win or not. If it does, it'd probably be the one I'm kind of like, oh, yeah, that one, you know. I didn't hate it. I don't think it's the worst movie I saw all year. But definitely the weakest out of the bunch, because every other film on this list, I can say, is a well-made, well-put-together film. Even the ones that are not my style. But I can't say that about Don't Look Up. I don't think it's a well-made film. Next film, if we're going in ranking, number nine is King Richard. This is a sports movie, you know, sports, which is not really my thing, you know. Sports biopic movies, not necessarily my style. So this is lower on the list because it's not really a movie for me, but it is a well-made and well-done movie, so that's why it gets the bump over a not-made well movie, even if it was something I liked. Don't Look Up. So King Richard is about Richard Williams, father of Venus and Serena Williams, who would go on to become masterclass tennis players, best in the world, the GOAT, right? That's his story of raising these girls and fighting to get them the recognition they deserve. And Will Smith is the main actor in it, and he's great. A lot of times he gets typecast as like the cool, chill dude. But every now and again, he comes in to remind you, oh, he knows how to tug the heartstrings out with his acting. So he's great in the movie. And there's so many kid actors in this movie, and they're great too. So that should automatically be a bonus, right? Good kid actors. I don't have too much to say about this one. Again, it's like, it's a good movie. It's quite inspiring. It's got a good message. At the very end, it was kind of getting me like, oh, yeah, I feel that. But sports biopic movies is not necessarily my thing. So again, that comes lower on the list. Not because I don't like it, but because everything else is more in my style. And I'm sure you can guess what my number one and my number two are out of the best picture pool, you know. Very biased, but it is me, and that's how we're rolling, you know. Okay, number eight is CODA. CODA stands for Child or Children of Deaf Adults. So CODA is a story, it's a coming-of-age movie. This young girl, high school student, soon graduating, and she's the only hearing person in her family. Both her older brother and her parents are deaf. So it's kind of a sort of a push and tug, push and pull, tug of war between her wanting to start a life as going off to music school, because she's a musician, well, she's a singer, she's got a very lovely, lovely voice. But being the only hearing person in her family, she's very responsible for being the interpreter and bridge to the hearing world for her, the rest of her family and their fishing business. So this one is, you know, a very emotional, sappy, feel-good family drama with lots of good humor in it. And yeah, I really liked this one. I think pretty much from here on out, it's all movies that I really enjoyed, right? That were my style. Again, not to diss on King Richard, it's a good movie. It's just not really for me. You know, I probably won't rewatch those ones, but here on out, everything else I'll probably rewatch. So yeah, CODA's great. Great acting in it. Good representation that all of the deaf actors are this is like a readaption, remake, reimagining of a French film, and that original one didn't have deaf actors in the deaf parts, so that's good that this one does. And they're hilarious, man. The parents in this movie are like the thirstiest parents I've ever seen in a film, right? The dad's just like, look at her, she's so beautiful. I just, you know, so many great moments of humor in there. And then they bring out the Joni Mitchell and get you in the heartstrings. But also, it's got an important message about working class being screwed over by rules and regulations, specifically in the fishing industry. So there's a lot to this movie. And I really liked it. Something about it gave me a very Life is Strange vibe. I think that's because we've got a main girl, and she's got a friend who's like, kind of looks like Chloe, you know, style. And it takes place in a, like, ocean town, right? Something about it was giving me Life is Strange vibes, but it has nothing like tornadoes destroying cities or flying whales or anything like that. There's no time travel powers in this one. So yeah, this one's very good, very enjoyable. I think this one's actually getting a little more push because it's winning a lot of the awards. So if this one ends up winning, I'd say, you know what, this is a good one. I say okay. Number 7 is Steven Spielberg's remake of the classic West Side Story. So before I watched this, I had actually never seen the original West Side Story or knew really anything about it. Because again, this is another genre that I'm not too into, and that's movie musicals. I can think of a few that I really love across the universe, because it's got Beatles songs and psychedelic imagery, and La La Land, because it's the director of Whiplash, and Ryan Gosling and Emma Stone, and so great, so gorgeous. And then, I don't think Pink Floyd's The Wall counts as a musical, per se. Not really. But I really like that, of course. So I'm not really a musical person, right? Not really my style. But I was hyped for this one because it's Steven Spielberg directing with cinematography by Yanis Kaminsky and great choreography, and some of the original people from West Side Story were involved in this new one. So lots of reasons to be hyped. And don't at me about how Steven Spielberg is like secretly a bad director because he makes sappy movies with happy endings. No. Schindler's List, Jurassic Park, E.T. the Extraterrestrial, Raiders of the Lost Ark, Jaws, Saving Private Ryan, Catch Me If You Can, Lincoln, Minority Report, AI Artificial Intelligence, Ready Player One, War Horse. I've probably forgotten a few off there as well. Like, the point is, Steven Spielberg's legitimately a great director and has made some of the best movies of all time. Yes, he also made Kingdom of the Crystal Skull. Every director has a couple of duds here or there. We can't do anything about that, but the man's great at filmmaking, and he's working with one of his best cinematographers, and he's doing a passion project remake of a cult classic that he has always wanted to do. So yeah, I was down for this movie, and it was pretty good. You know, as someone who's not really into the Romeo and Juliet musicals, I actually got pretty invested in this one. Gorgeous, such great music, very well done. And from what I've heard, it's a very great update on the source material. And let me put it this way, I found out like right before I watched this movie that the main actor, whose name we shall not say, is being accused of doing a lot of bad things. And despite that knowledge at hand, I was still invested in his character, right? Because the movie drew me in that well. I was thinking, like, all right, movie, you're gonna have to try pretty hard if you want to make me care about this horrible person. And Steven Spielberg was like, yo, I got this. So, but obviously, person in real life, yeah, no, just go. And then, what else? Well, there was the whole big controversy about the Spanish subtitles, right, that they weren't gonna subtitle the Spanish. Now, I'm a Canadian, I'm white, right? I took Spanish in high school, I don't really speak it. So I didn't mind that the Spanish wasn't subtitled, because it's for like brief moments here or there, and it's simple enough that you can like pretty much pick up on the context of everything that's being said. And I think the point was to make it so that the language was not being overridden by the English subtitles. Like, the whole movie's about language and a culture divide, and, you know, people wanting to be their own culture. So I think Spielberg, as he said, he felt that for them to come in and put it all over with English subtitles felt like it was covering up the language. So it's only for brief moments, small little lines here and there, nothing you can't infer the context of. As for all the other controversy on it, I don't know if I'm really at liberty to discuss. That's just how I felt. There was the movie Isle of Dogs, and I was interested in that because the whole thing is that they weren't gonna subtitle the Japanese spoken in that movie. And so I thought, oh, this will be some kind of interesting thing where we look at tonality and inflection of the voice to understand and get past a language barrier, right? But then they were just like, nah, we're just gonna bring in a white person to literally speak over the Japanese people and say, this is what you meant to say in English. So I didn't really like that element of Isle of Dogs that much. It just felt like lazy. Like, why don't you just put subtitles then if you're just gonna have someone translate everything for them? So the point is that all of these so-called controversial elements to West Side Story, you know, the main actor being who they are, and the lack of the subtitles and the fact that it's another remake, like, those things did not hamper my experience with it. If this does sound like stuff that would throw you off, well then, don't watch the movie, you know? You've got the original that you can watch. But I really enjoyed this one. And it sucks that it came out during a very big pandemic wave, while the new Spider-Man movie became one of the most popular movies ever. Because those were legitimate reasons for the movie bombing, but everybody decided to assume that it bombed because it was, you know, bowing to the woke agenda, you know. So, oh well. That brings us to number 6, which is The Power of the Dog. This is a Western movie, but it's kind of an anti-Western. You know, this is all about cool boys and gunslinging cowboys saving towns from bandits. It's kind of a deconstruction of gender roles and norms in a Western society and a Western movie, and it's a very odd and strange and slow movie with lots of pretty shots of the landscape. So this is definitely, now we're getting into more my style of film. This is the one that I think was the most biggest front runner for Best Picture. And if it does win, I'll be like, yeah, that's a good choice. I think this movie's pretty good. It's not one of my favorites, but it is very well done and well made. it's like a slow burn character piece that manages to reveal its twists and turns through, you know, small little moments and shots and stuff. And yeah, I really dug this one a lot. And it's gonna be really funny if this one wins and more people try to watch it, only to be like, this movie's so slow, there hasn't been an explosion in like 3 seconds, there hasn't been a side character constantly quipping humor, why is this the best picture? Like, because it's a cinematic experience of sharing an artistic vision through shot composition and technicality and, you know, the stuff that a best picture award should go to, not just the one where they were like, look, Spider-Man's on screen. Which is funny, because I actually like Spider-Man more than at least 6 or 7 of the films on this list. But I wouldn't give it best picture. You know what I'm saying? That brings us to number 5, and now 4 of these movies I already talked about in my best of 2021 list, so it's gonna be kind of rehashes from here on out. You know, I guess if you don't want to hear me rave about these movies again, you could not watch the video, you know, if you're into that sort of thing. So number 5 is Belfast. I loved this movie, you know, another coming-of-age story about a young boy growing up in the Belfast area during the big turbulent times of religious conflict in Ireland. The Protestants and the Catholics, and I'm sorry if I try to do my Irish accent here, I know it's probably not that great, but you know, you hear Belfast and you think about Irish and all that, you just kind of want to do the accent, right? Yeah, Belfast was such a great movie. It's heartwarming, but also dark. But there's some really great humor in this, like some hilarious moments. The bit with the one preacher of the church just going like, Protestants, you are all going to die. Hilarious. And it's a very personal movie directed by Kenneth Branagh, who, you know, that this was taking a lot from his childhood. And we actually got the 50 Shades of Grey guy, Jamie Dornan. He's actually great, who would have thought? And it's Katrina Balfe, who also got snubbed for an Oscar nod. She's great in the movie. Like to see her in some more roles. Like, everyone's great. And the soundtrack's great. Like that one song, Everlasting Love. Oh, so many feels. But for me, the standout performance is the actor who plays the grandfather. His name's like Kieran Hines or something like that. He's nominated, which is great. Like one of the best movie grandpas that there ever was, you know? And come on, the one line that he has, right? Yeah, where are you going? He's like, nowhere, you can't find me. I'm not crying, you're crying, right? But then also, there's so much magic in this movie. Kind of funny, this is like, I'm trying to think what the other movie was. I remember there's multiple movies where they're like, oh yeah, the other one was The French Dispatch. It's movies where they're shot in black and white, but it goes into color to show off art or when someone's being inspired. And it's in black and white, the movie Belfast, but then when the family is in a movie theater watching a movie, like, the movie on screen is in color. And I'm like, that's such a cool way to show the experience of, like, watching a great movie and feeling it, like, leap off the screen into your mind. So yeah, I just love that element of the film so much. There was so many great things going on here. Some people aren't a fan of sappy, you know, like, oh man, this one's legitimately great. Number four is Licorice Pizza. I've already talked about this movie in two other videos, a video talking about all of Paul Thomas Anderson's movies, and it made my top 10 of the year list, so I don't have too much more to add to it, but it's a great 70s throwback movie, and beautifully shot, and it's very fun. I like how it's just like a hangout movie, you know, where there's not a direct plot, it's a kind of a series of events, we just go through the motions. That felt very retro, I like that. I guess the one thing I could talk about is something I somehow managed two videos not to discuss, and it's the thing that is, for some people, gonna be a bit of a turnoff, and that's the age gap between our two main leads, right? The boys, what, like 15, 16, and the girls, like 25. You know, so there is that element to the movie. How do I say this? Like, I've watched so many movies where the main characters are, like, horrible people, or they do bad things. You're not meant to root for them, or there's horrible stuff that occurs in the film. And to me, I personally believe that depicting these events in a film does not automatically equal an endorsement of such things. But there is a great video going into depth on that topic, specifically about Licorice Pizza. So, I think perhaps the turnoff is that these characters seemingly do end up together, right? Like, it seems like they're gonna be in a relationship and everything's gonna be fine. Whereas, a lot of times, movies with this age gap, it's usually portrayed that if it's an older man, that he's quite a creep. Or that, you know, it doesn't work out as it should, you know, American Beauty, Lolita, Manhattan, right? So, yeah, that's kind of how I feel, and it's probably the fact that, like, if this movie came out in the 70s, I'm sure it kind of just would have been like, oh yeah, whatever, that's a thing people do in the 70s, right? Like, how many rock stars in the 70s had underage girlfriends? I'm not justifying it. I'm just saying, like, that was a thing, and it happened. But since the movie has come out now, it's like, eh, you know, it's an issue, right, I guess. I don't know, it's not a thing that bothers me watching the movie, because I've watched so many movies with bad characters, like Clockwork Orange is one of my favorite movies, and, you know, Alex DeLarge is not really a role model, per se. I mean, it's cool that he likes the great Ludwig von, but that's about it, right? So, that's how I view it, you know, I'm not against watching movies where it's not necessarily proper. This is an odd thing I've gotten myself into. I think y'all know what I mean. If that's the thing that bothers you, then don't watch this movie. And, you know, if you're fine with it, then it's okay, I guess. I don't know. Number three. This was the movie that I hadn't seen that I watched because the Oscars nominated it, and the one I ended up liking the most out of the new movies I hadn't seen. And this is Drive My Car. It's a 3-hour Japanese movie about a guy sitting in a car while someone else drives him around, and he listens to cassette tapes of his wife speaking lines from a play that then he says back in response, having his lines memorized, and he's trying to put on a multilingual adaptation of a play from Chekhov, you know, like, that's where the Chekhov's gun trope comes from. So yeah, this is a very odd movie, and it definitely starts out quite strange. Like, from the very first conversation, you're kind of like, what's exactly going on here? What is this all about? And really gets you hooked. You know, I was really invested, and I didn't think I was going to end up loving this movie, but I did. I mean, it's a slow 3-hour movie with lots of pretty shots of landscape, so that's definitely a big draw for me. I like that. And yeah, it really takes like 40 minutes for the movie to properly start, but once it does, I was like, okay, I'm all set to see where this goes from here. Ultimately, it is a movie about the importance of the journey. It's not about the destination, it's about the journey. Hence why so much of this movie's runtime is dedicated to showing the journey. Driving from point A to point B, bringing the car onto the ferry so the ferry can go to the next point so the car can get off the ferry and travel to its destination, right? A lot of driving scenes in this movie. Because again, I feel like that's the point. That's why it's such a long movie. You know, could you have trimmed it down? Yeah, maybe, but I don't know. There was something very, very zen about it. Like, I love blasting my great pumped up tunes in a car, but sometimes you just want to, like, drive at a good pace, turn the music off, and just listen to the sounds. That's what this movie is. I'm actually really surprised this movie got nominated, because it's a 3-hour Japanese movie about people driving cars, listening to cassette tapes of people speaking lines from a Chekhov play. Like, don't get me wrong, this is a great movie, I love it, but like, I thought they would have gone for something a little more typical Oscar baity, you know, not Parasite 2.0. But then again, I didn't think Parasite was going to win the big trophy, and it did, and it's a great movie. So yeah, if this one wins, I almost want it to win, so that so many people are going to be like, oh, let's watch this, it got good reviews, and then they're like, this is a 3-hour movie where I have to read subtitles. And then the first conversation is about, oh, I have an idea for a play. It involves a girl who's stalking a dude, and she sneaks into his home and stuff. And they're going to be like, what? What is the Academy on? So I almost wanted to win just because of that. But yeah, I think this is a great movie. You just kind of got to be in the mood for it, though. You know, I do love it, but it's not one I'm going to just watch at any time. And funny enough, we get to the final two on the list, and it's both two films that I loved, but I didn't think these movies had any chance of being up for Best Picture, and yet here we are, so that's great. Number two is Nightmare Alley, the new Guillermo del Toro movie. It's a remake of a 1940s movie that was originally like a kind of pulp novel type thing, I don't know. So perhaps this movie had that going for it, you know, throwback to the golden age. But it's great, man. This movie's great. It's so gorgeous. If it wasn't for the other movie that's number one, I'd give this one all of the tech awards and the production awards and stuff like that, and the score and everything. Oh, so great. And I also like that this movie, like Drive My Car, is not afraid to take its time setting things up. Like, I feel it's literally 1 hour before Nightmare Alley actually starts, because it's not afraid to just let the pieces to the story fall into place at a natural development and let everything build upon the layers. Sure, you could have just started from when Bradley Cooper is doing his whole mind illusionist thing in a big fancy dinner party thing, but to have that hour of setting up who he is, he's got a strange backstory, meeting the cute girl, falling into trouble, establishing the themes of the carny and the geek, Willem Dafoe doing his whole step right up, folks, is he man or is he beast, right, stacking eggs on me. movies don't have to start with an action scene right away or have jokes every 5 minutes. You open yourself up to a whole wonderful world of possibilities. And again, apart from Drive My Car, I wouldn't say any of these movies are that unconventional, you know? This isn't like some 7-hour Hungarian film about nothing, or like a movie about a pigeon watching surveillance government stuff in Serbia or whatever it is, you know? There's nothing like that. But yeah, Nightmare Alley's great. I'll probably have to talk about it again when I eventually do a all Guillermo del Toro movies review. So yeah, I love this. Such a great movie. Gets better every time I see it. And of course, that brings us to number one, which, if you knew anything about me, you probably guessed it already. I did a whole review for it. I did a review of all of this director's films. And then it was my second favorite movie of 2021, behind The Green Knight. And that's Dune. Of course it's Dune. What else would it be? Did you think that I had changed my mind? No. I'm a science fiction person. And somebody, I don't know who directed this movie. They're not up for best director. Whoever made this movie, they did a great job, because they took a classic novel that had already been made into a less than perfect movie that I still enjoy. Something that has so many influences in so many other science fiction works, right? Dune, and they finally made a good movie out of it, and we're getting a part two, and I'm so hyped for that. It's everything I wanted it to be, and I can only sing its praises so much. So I'm very glad this movie got nominated for Best Picture, because it's not gonna win, of course not. I'm hoping it'll be like a Return of the King situation, where like it's the final one that they throw all the awards at, you know, as not only to recognize it being the best one, but to, you know, collectively give the awards to everything. Like Return of the King, rightfully deserved, because Lord of the Rings, man, I mean, you know, right? But yeah, just the fact that it got nominated, I think that's great, because there's not too many, like, straight up out there science fiction movies that get Oscar recognition, right? Like, original Star Wars, A New Hope got nominated for Best Picture. Sigourney Weaver got nominated for Best Actress for Aliens. Funny enough, the person she lost to is Marley Martin, I think is her name. She's one of the main actresses in Coda. Things are connected. And then you had, like, The Martian or Apollo 13. But those movies, while they are, like, outer space movies, they're not, like, weird, crazy, giant sandworms, mind-expanding, hallucinogens-type science fiction movies, right? Or then you've got the movies that are kind of science fiction, but they're not too into it, you know, like Inception or Mad Max Fury Road. There's, like, elements of it, but it's, again, not hardcore, crazy, outer space, mind powers, Spice Girls, witches, and things like that. So the fact that it's gotten recognized, a very hardcore genre film, I'd say that's an achievement. So here's hoping we get more awards recognition for future Dune installments. And yeah, that's about that. That's all I got. Sorry for all the traffic sounds. I mean, I try to edit them out because I do live in a more populated area, but sometimes when I've got to film, the only time I've got to film is in the middle of the week, and then it's just more busy, so sorry. You know, maybe if you live in a busy neighborhood, then this is just used to it. You know, I can tune it out so well these days. And, you know, we'll see what wins, what loses. But yeah, that's how I stand. So it was, for the most part, fun getting to watch all these movies and find a couple new ones and, see where we go from here. But Dune is still the best because it's Dune, of course. Oh, and Elden Ring update. I beat General Radahn. That was fun. I hope you guys don't mind, but for some boss fights, I'm using the Spirit Ashes because it's fun. And also, if the game says they're gonna throw not one, not two, but three of those crystalline guys and in a small room with Scarlet Rot buildup, you damn bet yourself that I'm bringing in my own help. If they're gonna throw two of a guy at me, then I'm gonna throw two of myself at them. Because that's how it is. Also, it sucks because I was all getting high-leveled enough to fight Skarsgård Radahn. And then, like, the day before I fight him is the day they put out a patch that apparently nerfed him. And I'm never gonna find out what it was like. But then again, I used summons anyways for that fight because they give you all these NPC summons. Like, it's all like charging, like, yeah, let's go get him, boys. And I just couldn't resist the opportunity to have Wolfman and Samurai and Potboy and not Patches fighting alongside me. So, sorry if that makes me less of a hardcore Souls gamer, but it's a legitimate thing in the game, and sometimes you just gotta. Plus, this game is definitely Dark Souls at its most, because they did that thing in Dark Souls 2 where, like, they took a boss and then the later boss was just two of that guy. Oh man, it's gonna happen so many times in this game, I know it. We all thought it was Dark Souls 3 2. It's actually Dark Souls 2 2. And that's why they put two of every boss.